Welcome to part two of week two's lesson. In this lesson, students will be able to use the determinant to find the inverse of a matrix if it exists. Continue to take notes on your capture sheet you used in part one. Can you find a matrix that could satisfy each statement? A matrix that works in these statements is called an inverse matrix. The first one is the inverse of the given matrix for addition. The second is the inverse of the given matrix for multiplication. Now let's look at this in more detail. In the discussion board, you were asked to find matrices that would replace these question marks. How did you do? Was one of these scenarios easier than the other? Here are the answers. The matrices you found are called identity matrices. The first one is the identity for addition. The second one is the identity for multiplication. What if the given matrices were 3 by 2? Would there be an identity matrix? What size would it be? For addition, the answer is yes. The identity matrix would be a 3 by 2 matrix with entries that were all 0. For multiplication, the answer is no. The dimensions wouldn't work. Multiplicative identities have to be square. Next, consider if the order changes. Would the answers remain the same? In this case, yes. In this lesson, we will further investigate this scenario for multiplication. Additive inverses are not very interesting. They don't come up in many real-world situations. So when we talk about the inverse of a matrix and don't specify whether it's addition or multiplication, we will assume it's multiplication. The inverse matrix of an n by n matrix A is the matrix B if A times B equals B times A, which equals what's known as the identity matrix. Note that we are saying both matrices A and B are square. Why would they need to be square? According to our definition, both products A times B and B times A must be defined and give the same result. They have to be square for that to happen, and the result must be the identity matrix. Notice its structure. A diagonal from left to right, known as the main diagonal, consists of ones and the remaining entries are zero. How can we find the inverse of the given matrix? To find the inverse matrix, we can solve a simple system of equations using what we know about matrix multiplication to set it up. In the past, you've learned to solve these systems by several different methods. For now, we will just focus on the result. Now that we have our result, verify that it works. Does it work in the reverse order? Using what we previously learned about multiplying matrices, we see that it does. Now consider the diagonals of these matrices. Do you see a pattern? Can you make a conjecture? Look at the main diagonals. And the other diagonals? Pause the video and make notes on your capture sheet. We notice the values on the main diagonal switch places while the values on the other diagonal stay in the same place, but change signs. Let's apply this learning to another example. Now let's try to use the patterns we discovered in the previous scenario to predict the inverse of this given matrix. We will then verify our answer. What do you think the inverse will be? Consider what we saw about the diagonals previously. Let's start with the main diagonal. We saw these values will switch locations. Now let's look at the other diagonal. We saw these values' signs will change. Now we can multiply the matrices to verify our answer. Pause the video and try it on your capture sheet. Oops, why didn't it work? What can we do to make it work? Now, where do you think the 2 came from? When did we have a scalar identified with a matrix? Yes, 2 is the determinant of the given matrix. Verify that. Dividing by the determinant will give the identity matrix as the result. Why do you think this step was not necessary in the previous example? In the previous example, the determinant was 1. Now that we have investigated inverses of matrices, we can formalize the process we used. First, note the notation that we use for the inverse of a matrix. The negative 1 is not an exponent. It is read A inverse and refers to the multiplicative inverse of A. This is similar to the notation we use for the inverse of a function. Here is the formula. It has 2 main parts. Dividing the values by the determinant of the original matrix, which is represented with this reciprocal notation. Rearranging the locations and signs of elements in the matrix using what we discovered about the relationship in the diagonals. We will now find an inverse matrix using the formula. We will use the formula to find the inverse matrix of A. First, pause the video and try it on your capture sheet. Recall the 2 main parts of the formula. We need to use the determinant and arrange the elements in the matrix. Let's start with the determinant. This is the value we will be dividing by. Notice, according to the formula, we rewrite the reciprocal of 2, which is 1/2. Now we will use our learning about the diagonals. The elements of the main diagonal will switch places. The elements of the other diagonal will have opposite signs. Finally, we will divide all elements by our determinant of 2, or think of it as multiplying by the scalar of 1/2. This gives our final inverse matrix for A. Try to find the inverse of this matrix B. Pause the video and try it on your capture sheet. Now let's see the steps. First, you may have found the determinant to be 0. Next, you would arrange the elements in your matrix. According to our formula, we will divide the elements by our determinant, or multiply by its reciprocal. Do we have a problem? Yes, if the determinant of a matrix is 0, then it does not have an inverse. Such a matrix is called a singular matrix. Let's change this scenario a little. For what value of x will the matrix below not have an inverse? Pause the video and try it on your capture sheet. Recall our formula for the inverse matrix. In the previous example, we saw the determinant cannot be 0. This is what we will set our determinant equal to. Remembering our determinant formula, we can set up the equation to solve. Using algebra, we can solve the equation. What about 3x3 matrices? In order for the matrices A and B below to be inverses, what must the value of X be? We can choose any row vector in matrix A. We will select the first row. Choose the third column in matrix B because that's where the variable is. Choose this corresponding row column entry in the identity matrix, which is 0 in this case. Then set up the equation formed by the dot product of these two vectors. Using algebra, we can solve. To find the inverse of a larger matrix like a 3x3, we will use technology, a TI-84 calculator. Be sure to check the resources listed for how you can access one of these for free. This is the sequence of steps we will follow to find the inverse of A. They are also provided on your capture sheet. Matrix A has already been entered here, and now I will compute its inverse. We can also calculate the values as fractions. So here is our resulting inverse matrix. Now let's use technology for a slightly different scenario. We will now verify that these matrices A and B are inverses. How might we check this? What do you recall about the product of inverse matrices from the beginning of this lesson? The result must be the identity matrix. The product should be verified for both A times B and B times A. We will use these steps in the calculator similar to the previous example. Again, these are provided on your capture sheet. Both matrices A and B have been entered here. I will now check both products. Are these two matrices inverses? Yes, they are. Each product resulted in the identity matrix. Wow, we saw many ideas about matrices and their inverses in this lesson. As we conclude, consider this big idea. What are two requirements for a matrix to have an inverse? It must be a square n by n matrix, and the determinant cannot equal 0. Now practice your learning of inverse matrices with Khan Academy. Then when you are ready, take the Check for Understanding quiz on MyMCPS.